Welcome to Shades of Us. I'm your host, Daryl Brown. Central Park is one of the great communal spaces in our city.
On this episode, we will delve into some other spaces where people are sharing their connections with each other in the fields of music, dance, and photography. According to a 2021 survey conducted by TuneCore and Media Research, 64% of respondents named sexual harassment and objectification as a major challenge women face in the music industry.
Let's visit with two women who decided to use their own journey as professional musicians to help elevate underrepresented and overlooked musicians of New York.
When you are the only person of a gender or of ethnicity, you need to be included in the conversation. Otherwise, like, what happens is you start integrating feelings of, I'm not worth to have this conversation.
My name is Jen Shyu. Yeah, I'm one of the co-founders of Mutual Mentorship for Musicians, or what we call M3. I'm a composer, vocalist, multi-instrumentalist, and dancer, and producer, and educator. M3 is a beautiful organization that we formed to support women and non-binary composer performers who we feel should be more seen and amplified.
My name is Sara Serpa. I'm a vocalist, composer, educator, producer, and also co-founder of Mutual Mentorship for Musicians. Through different activities, we try to fulfill gaps that we felt we had during our upbringing as musicians and also as performers. The gaps that we have noticed are lack of performance opportunities, ageism, so after a certain age, women become non-relevant to the scene, and isolation also, like, because many times women and non-binary musicians are the only non-male musicians in the room, that can create a lot of feelings of isolation and not feeling supported. We all learn from each other, where older musicians will learn from younger musicians and vice versa.
Subi Chinoka and I were partners. We were randomly paired together. It was an amazing chemistry that we had. I don't know if I would have worked with her otherwise, you know, because she lives in Philly. She's in her 60s.
So right now we have these four kind of branches. Each one of them is equally important in building community and building alternative narratives to what we have been used to. We have the cohort and the commissions. And so the artists, basically, they have to co-create a piece together. And then at the end of the journey, they also write an essay or a poem for the anthology, where they're kind of supported by music writers that we hire to help them crafting their piece.
I think one of the essays that was so powerful was Eli Maliwan's, where he talked about what it was like to be a saxophonist as a woman and then transitioning to becoming a man, and how he was treated differently. They listened to him, you know, they seemed to respect him, or they had, you know,
made comments about his music.
Yeah. And actually, they didn't talk about his body anymore, you know? So like, that was really powerful that he had the courage to write about that experience and going through. We've realized a lot of artists in our cohorts are not used to writing about their work. It's important for us to talk about our work because, first of all, there's such a lack of women and women of color writers. And of course, we depend on good reviews or just having our music written about in general. And if we are only seen through the lens of people who just maybe don't understand our work, we just know how important that skill is for us to write about our work in our own words if no one else is going to do it. After a
while. M3's Lifetime Achievement Award is an annual award that we're giving to older members of our M3 community to recognize their contributions to our musical scene.
First awardee was Shantanu Rula, who's an amazing storyteller and a sitar player and bira player, composer, based in Chicago. She was just recalling, you know, I had to get on a plane in a wheelchair. Why couldn't this have happened 10, 20 years ago? It shouldn't be that this is her first time playing in New York City. You know, as innovative as she is, no one else is doing what she's doing.
Our festival, which started last year, and this year will be in September, where we really want to feature the musicians in person and where they're invited to either present their own projects or collaborate together.
You know, we try to have a really good balance of instrumentation within a cohort to see people playing all these different instruments and not just playing them, but like masterful at them, you know? That is inspiring to others and also inspiring to men, young men who are seeing that, and that makes an impact. There's a community there and they're just working together. I certainly didn't have that when I was 20 something when I moved to New York, you know?
Yeah.
It was really just like, you know, Sara and I, we were islands.
Yeah, exactly.
Know? And then to see them like, oh, they're an ocean. They're all like mixing together. But it's beautiful that, for instance, one of our artists from our first cohort, Tamika Reed, who's an amazing cellist composer, recent MacArthur Fellow awardee, she texted me, do you recommend any, you know, artists, string players? And of course, I recommended Leonor Falcon from our fourth cohort. And Tamika said, oh yeah, I'd heard about her, but I haven't connected with her. A lot of our artists or people will approach us like, hey, we're looking for artists for our festival and can you recommend? And I just say, yes, go to our website. Go to M3's website and you can, you know, all of our artists are linked and also their instruments and locations are there.
New York is a very special place, you know, where things move very quickly and when there's a change, people embrace that change very quickly. Although we are creating an alternative scene, like how actually that scene is going to permeate the other scenes, it's still something that we want to see. You know, younger generation have much more power, like to complain and make their voices heard. And they're lucky for that. For us, it was definitely different. And for older musicians, definitely different. Like, there's not even a way to compare it. You really had to be quiet and do what was expected from you and not complain, you know, like sometimes we carry a lot of thoughts and emotions throughout our professional life and secrets, you know, also like a lot of silences. And how like talking about those things kind of normalizes these feelings and also makes us not focus so much on these negative things that happen, but actually really empower and amplify the positive things and great things that all the musicians are creating.
According to a 2020 Pew Research Center survey, 60% of U.S. adults said they are very familiar with their origins. Only 46% said they feel a strong connection to their family's cultural roots. And only a third said their origin is central to their identity.
More Americans are using DNA to figure out their ethnic identity and track ancestry. We take a look back at a photographer who has helped people connect to a deeper sense of their ethnic heritage.
As that portrait photographer, you're really working with emotions with the person. And so as they get into the hair and makeup, as they get into the clothing, they start to think about themselves as, who am I? Where am I from? My name is Brooklyn McTavish. I'm a photographic social psychologist, focusing primarily on ethnic diversity through DNA analysis. I'm trying to have a conversation with people through the photography about how society views us ethnically and how ethnicity changes society. Well, it started off when I was about 14 or 15. I was really trying to understand how society saw me as an African American. I was born in Fort Greene, Brooklyn. My mom is from North Carolina. She is the second generation born out of slavery. My father is from Nigeria, Lagos, Nigeria. So when DNA first started to come out, people were really trying to understand, like, what does it mean? How can you use DNA to explain certain things about yourself? I knew that I had English or Scottish in me, My mother's surname is Watson. Her mother's surname is McCray. We also knew that in North Carolina, we had Caucasian relatives. But being that I knew so much about my African-American side of the family, it was really trying to put more points on the African side of me. We knew that we had Caucasian relatives. We knew that we were heavily mixed on my mother and grandmother's side. That's just how life was for people in the South. On my father's side, because there wasn't enough samples there, I really couldn't be sure. The thing that struck me the most was part of me was Germanic. I'm 1% Swedish, I'm 1% German, versus the higher concentrations of African and Scottish DNA within my profile. On the African side, because everything was really more in an oral tradition, there wasn't a lot of pictures or photography in West Africa at that time. So everything was passed down through the tribe. You know, your grandmother, your grandfather, they kept the family traditions alive. So the thesis project that I had in my master's program was called The Sum of the Sum of Us. The thesis was based on looking at the individual as they are today and asking a question, who do you think you are as an American? Are you white? Are you black? Are you mixed race? What do you consider yourself to be? And then what would happen if you found out that you weren't this thing? What if you found out that you had more European in you than African? Or you found you had more African in you than European, but you looked white or you looked black? Would that change your experience? So photography became a way to visually represent that based on other people's studies into DNA. And so the project was to take that information, make it more tangible through an experience of going through and changing how you look to be more aligned with your ethnic background and what that experience would be, and then having a conversation about that. The subject selection was a random process. It started off with people who I knew that were interested in knowing more about their past, and so I tried to select people from every walk of life that I had in my test population, different age groups, and also different ethnic backgrounds. The point is to prove that we're all related. Science tells us that we all originated from a common ancestor. And as we migrated out of Africa due to weather conditions and the sun, and also our interbreeding with other species of human at the time, that gave us our different looks that we have today. And so trying to find people who were very different from each other, and then realizing that through the DNA and through their oral traditions, they were very similar. First, we do an interview and we capture your oral tradition, your story, before you take the DNA. And the second phase, we put you through the DNA processing, and then we get your DNA back. From there, we look at it together, what your DNA breakdowns, what we call your ethnic estimates, what they are. And then we do research into your culture, into costuming. And then from there, we then build and construct a costuming based on your oral tradition and your DNA evidence. And that's how we get the portraits. So the costuming takes them out of their everyday experience. There's an old shamanistic way of viewing the world, and that in order to bring new things into the world, you have to break the old things. So by dressing people in the garb and the hair and makeup of their culture, takes them out of their everyday experience and transports them to a world in between. You are who you are, but you also are who your family line and traditions were. And so by bringing those things together through this visual medium, gives them the experience to step out of their day-to-day. So I'm gonna say 80% of the subjects were in awe of what they found out. A lot of them didn't have a clue about where they came from. They had a very strong oral tradition for people who had families that were still alive. Some people were adopted. They didn't know anything about themselves. When we got into the costuming process, the sitting in the makeup chair, the fact that we shaved your beard off and we put a fake beard on you, there was silence when people stepped out of the makeup chair to see themselves in a mirror as how they would be represented as their ancestral past. And then putting on the clothing, some people felt like this was like being at home. This is the most comfortable thing I've ever put on, and it feels like me. And then once we did the portraits and we edited them, some people cried. Some people showed it to their parents. Their parents cried because they're like, you know, we always knew that this is where we were from. It's very pleasing to see that people are aware that there are differences, but also they're aware there are commonalities. And through this experience, they start to question themselves. They start to question how they view other people. When you find out that you are a percentage of something else and that your experience can be changed based on that, is a very palatable thing. sometimes in a positive way, sometimes in a negative way. For African Americans and Americans as a whole, coming out of the era of slavery into freedom, there were rules, you know, the one drop rule. If you had one drop of black blood in you, if you were white, you were black. But it doesn't work in reverse. If you have one drop of white blood in you, it doesn't make you white, it makes you black. And so people have to come to terms with these concepts. And as more and more people see how connected we are genetically, those concepts, those outdated concepts, should be questioned. Because America, diversity is a black or white thing. It's not a black and Spanish thing. It's not a white and Asian thing. Is that a right way to define yourself as your most dominant side or what society defines you as? I believe it should open up a greater conversation about diversity. So DNA is only part of the story. The project and my art helps further that conversation along. We're going to take what we know about you from your oral tradition, from your family experience. We're going to take from you what the DNA tells us. So merging these things together in your own human experience, I believe, informs who you are and how you interact with society, and conversely, how society interacts with you. Once we complete the work, the interviews, looking at the DNA, doing the research into their customs for the costuming, it's such an amazing experience because every person's unique. You get to choose from a kaleidoscope of people and their experience, from people who could have been from the House of Lords or common people. And so being able to bring those things together visually to tell a story for me is a most unique experience.
We'll be back after this break. Finally, we meet a filmmaker whose newfound passion for salsa has translated into her work. And now she's become an organizer of salsa-focused events that help preserve the history of the dance form.
All my productions, I tend to give opportunities to minority groups and women of all ages. I'm known as Bianca Widakay in the artistic community. I'm the founder of Production Gurls and the director and creator of Salsa Stories Community Engagement Program. I identify as Brasicua, born and raised in Brazil. Got into New York City in the year 2000 and right away was adopted by the New Yorican communities. We don't listen to salsa, that's not part of our culture, right? So as opposed to people here, they grow up listening to salsa in their household. That didn't happen to me. Once I got in New York City, I got hooked from this salsa world. That became part of my investigating my cultural identity once I got in New York City. I wasn't happy with myself. I was very restless. And I started to pay attention and listen to the things that I enjoy in life. That's when I came across Manhattan Neighborhood Network. It's an educational institution, and I'm a certified producer. It provides instruction to the community. I decided to create this project, Salsa Stories, to explore my own cultural identity. Salsa is very related to social political movements, displacement, migration. Salsa Stories started off as a documentary. I'm a cultural curator. I select people that I think are fascinating when they share their own stories with salsa, how salsa came about, how salsa is very connected with activism and social cultural identity. MNN was one of the places where I could air my documentary, and BronxNet as well. But I wanted the project to be 360. I wanted to collect those stories from the community and then present it back in the communities where they were collected. 2020 comes. Once the documentary was completed, I came across this opportunity from the city to support artists to bring cultural programs outdoors. It became Open Streets. When I heard about it, I was like, that's it. I am going to select communities in New York City that were very strong in the creation of salsa and I'm going to bring the documentary there. Since I was taking the documentary on the streets, why not have some live music? So I invited people I know in this big community celebration, and they all agreed and came together. And then I thought, maybe I'll put a photo exhibition of the people who appears in the documentary and create this cultural hub. Now, this is nothing new. I'm not reinventing the wheel. I'm not taking credit for, you know, creating this cultural hub. This has been done before. Chino Garcia from Charas in the Lower East Side, he's the OG to create cultural hubs and meets all those approaches together. Housing and environmentalism and arts and culture, education, bringing people together to reconnect, educate, socialize, right? He says that it's not community engagement the way we call it today, it's community participation. When you come to my events, you will see me wearing two hats, which is a producer, because I'm directing everybody, a director producer, and a host, because I'm dancing with people and entertaining them. The vast majority of the target audience for the Salsa Stories, they are in their 70s and 80s, right? These are the OGs, the witnesses, the people who witnessed this cultural movement. But there's a lot of people who are second, third generation Latinos who don't speak Spanish, right? Their grandparents migrated, and they now come to realize that they want to get close to their cultural identity. They want to explore that. And that's why I bring salsa classes. This is one of the elements. There's always free salsa classes for those people in search of their cultural identity. And it's a great opportunity to reconnect with the elderly. The communities where I bring those events that were influenced by the creation of salsa, that's where salsa was born, in the Lower East Side, the South Bronx, and East Harlem, they are going through gentrification. Where I see this project going is expanding the collaborations and partnerships with community organizations that are in the same wavelength. As an example, when I bring Salsa Stories to the South Bronx, I envision to expand collaborations with organizations, grassroots organizations such as BronxNet, Bronx Documentary Center, Ghetto Film School, and FOCO, organizations that provide training for media making and job searching. And I can offer that space for people interested in creating content and producing events where they can have hands-on experience on this environment. When I look in the mirror, I see someone who is very fortunate with that. It's a little bit uncomfortable. I found to nurture and heal that feeling is extending my fortune to the people who are not as fortunate as I am. Everything that I put my mind into, I accomplish.
That's our show. If you want to know more about the guests we featured, check out our Instagram page at Shades of Us TV and online at tv.cuny.edu. I'm Darryl Brown. See you next time on Shades of Us.